All right, let's get started. Welcome everyone to the third lecture in our Tilden Arts online series. I'm Kathy McCarron, the Dean of Arts and Humanities, and I want to thank you very much for being here tonight. This Zoom room is bursting at the seams, and I guess you must all be as excited as I am to hear some Irish poetry tonight. We are thrilled to offer 10 events in this series, ranging from tonight's compelling lecture to hands-on workshops in drawing and collage. Our next event is Thursday, April 1st at 4 p.m., when Scottish photographer and filmmaker Colin McPherson will join us from Scotland to present Picturing Scotland's Last Salmon Net Fisherman, a visual exploration of how a traditional rural university became the catalyst for questions about community, the environment, and politics and power in contemporary Scottish life. Tilden Arts Online also includes three other series you may be interested in: the Higgins Art Gallery virtual exhibits and panel discussions, the Bigger Boat Visiting Writers series, which welcomes renowned fiction writer Susanna Feltz tomorrow night at 6:30, and the weekly foreign film series. You can visit our brand new website, www.capecod.edu/tildenonline, or send me an email if you'd like more details. We are looking forward to a spring semester full of fun, provocative, and uplifting events. And it now gives me great pleasure to introduce tonight's presenter, Dr. Daniel Burt. Daniel S. Burt received his PhD in English and American Literature from New York University. He has taught graduate and undergraduate courses in writing and literature at NYU, Wesleyan University, Northeastern, and elsewhere for three decades. He has been a faculty member at Cape Cod Community College since 2010. Daniel served for almost a decade as a dean at Wesleyan University. And since 2003, he has been organizing literary and historical tours of Ireland as the co-owner of Unique Irish Tours. He is the author of more than 10 books, including the Handy Literature Answer Book with Deborah G. Felder, the Drama 100, the Novel 100, and the Literary 100, the Chronology of American Literature, and the Biography Book. He is currently at work on a book of the origin stories behind some of the greatest novels ever written, and he lives in South Chatham. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Daniel Burt. And before Daniel starts speaking, if anybody does not want the live transcript on, you can, at the bottom of your screen, click on the little CC and you can turn it off. Okay, Daniel, welcome.
Okay, well, welcome everybody. Let me first of all, I want to thank the organizers and particularly Kathy for inviting me to participate. I'm delighted that you've all joined me in my shed. You are in an 8-by-10-foot garden shed in our woods. This is certainly the most number of people that have ever been inside my shed. And I am absolutely delighted to welcome you. Although this is starting to remind me of my very first time that I was ever asked to be a DJ at a college radio station. They gave me like the dawn shift, and it was the most miserable experience of my entire life, trying to talk, spin discs, et cetera, et cetera. They never asked me back. So just keep that in mind as we proceed. I should say that I put together a kind of a visual sort of, it's always good, I think, to have something to look at while I'm talking to distract you. So I'm gonna share my screen. I hope that I've not tricked you too much into coming to this talk with the title, The Best Poets in the World, The Role of the Irish in the Biden Administration. I am by no means someone with any inside information about our new president, nor do I know much more than the average bystander about the inner workings of the Biden administration. You may feel I've co-opted topicality in the interests of getting here and talking about things Irish. And there is definitely something to that. This summer was the first time in more than a decade that I failed to visit Ireland. And by now, withdrawal from Irish friends, scenery, and Irish intoxicants, cultural or otherwise, is absolutely severe. This talk, however, started with being absolutely relieved when I discovered that we had elected a president who actually reads and even reads poetry, someone not shy about sharing his connections to Ireland and particularly his love affair with Irish poetry. Biden's, the president's relationship with Irish poetry goes well back to his early years, standing in front of a mirror, practicing, reciting W.B. Yeats' poems to help him conquer his stutter. As a result, he committed long passages of Irish poems to memory that he still draws upon. He recalled during his Senate years how his colleagues always kid me about quoting Irish poets all the time. They think I do it because I'm Irish. I do it because they are the best poets. We all know by now how reliant the now president is on Seamus Heaney, and particularly on Heaney's poem, The Cure of Troy, with its repeated lines about hope and history rhyming. This poem is so ingrained and so constant in Biden's frame of reference that his daughter quoted the poem back at him when she had learned that he had been asked to serve as President Obama's vice president. Biden recalls, she said, "You know how you're always quoting Seamus Heaney about hope and history rhyming?" And I said, "Yeah." And she said, "This is hope and history. I'm history. Here's hope." Biden's passion for Irish poetry has become something of a defining characteristic of the man, like his aviator sunglasses. Here's when President Obama presented his vice president with the Medal of Freedom. Watch Obama's reaction to Biden announcing yet another Irish quote, and Biden's retort when the audience chuckles about the honoree's well-known Irish poetry compulsion.
Whoops. The best vice president America's ever had, Mr. Joe Biden. As Yeats put it, because I had to quote an Irish poet, and Seamus Heaney was taken. "Think where man's glory most begins and ends, and say my glory was I had such friends."
You know I can't let a comment go by without quoting an Irish poet. And Seamus Heaney, in one of his poems, said, when you can find someone who says it better, use it. He said, "You carried your own burden, and very soon your symptoms of creeping privilege disappeared." You carried your own burdens, and very soon the creeping symptoms of privilege disappeared. Mr. President, you have sometimes been like a lone wolf, but you carried yourself in a way that is pretty remarkable. The history of the journey, your journey, is something people are going to write about in a long time.
Well, Heaney's lines on history and hope rhyming served as the peroration of Biden's accepting the nomination at the Democratic National Convention. It also became an ad during the campaign, the soundtrack of which RTE, Ireland's national television radio broadcaster, used to close their broadcast the day the election was called.
And that is the news this Saturday evening. On the night, Joe Biden is elected US president, a proud Irish American and admirer of the Nobel laureate Seamus Heaney. We leave you now tonight with his words. Good night and take care.
human beings suffer. They torture one another. They get hurt and get hard. No poem or play or song can fully right the wrong inflicted and endured. History says, don't hope on this side of the grave. But then, once in a lifetime, the long-for tidal wave of justice can rise up and hope and history rhyme. So hope for a great sea change on the far side of revenge. Believe that a further shore is reachable from here. Believe in miracles and healing wells. Call miracles self-healing and utter self-revealing, double take of feeling. If there is a fire in the mountain or lightning in a storm, and God speaks from the sky, that means someone is hearing the outcry and the birth cry of a new life at its turn. It means once in a lifetime that justice can rise up and hope and history rhyme.
They say that you campaign in poetry, but you have to govern in prose. And the question I'd like to take up this evening is, what role, if any, should poetry play in politics? And more specifically, what can the Irish poets that President Biden draws on so extensively teach us about hope, history, and governing, and the imaginative landscape of our new president? Let's first pause for just a moment to consider the sheer outrageousness of my talk's title, The Best Poets in the World. Not the best part, that's a judgment call. And as Jane Austen's Emma Woodhouse observes, there's no disputing about taste. Instead of debating the best designation, I'd like you to consider the phrase in the world. That is, the contention that the world's greatest poets come from Ireland. On the face of it, this is one of the most astonishingly grandiose assertions comparable to comparing or claiming that American literature is dominated by the Aleuts or the Inuits of Alaska. Measured by its location, tiny size, and equally petite population, Ireland has no business dominating anything, but here we are. At Stop and Shop, as soon as they clear away the reds and pinks of Valentine's Day, it's time to bring out the green. What other country's National Saints Day is the occasion for a worldwide celebration of all things Irish and a joyous demonstration of allegiance and affection? There's Bastille Day, Cinco de Mayo, and July 4th, of course. But no national celebration compares to March 17th in its reach and its cultural saturation. This is astonishing, considering that Ireland is a relatively remote island on the edge of Europe, whose next parish over, as the saying goes, is Boston. You will be reminded of Ireland's intimacy immediately when you visit. You will notice that the newscasts give the weather of the entire country in a single go. And a fatal car crash in remote Kerry becomes a national tragedy. A quick look at Ireland's population and size makes this apparent. I'll let you read my statistics here. I like the idea that they took Ireland and dropped it in the middle of the United States, and that's how much of an impact it has. It's about the size of Indiana. It is 174 miles long, wide, and 302 miles long. This is one of the great statistics I like. Butte, Montana is six times the size of Dublin. That's extraordinary. Butte, Montana. This is a picture of me arriving in Dublin, and where do I go next? I cross the entire country to get to Sligo. It takes 2.5 hours, well, close to three. It's going to be much quicker because it's super highway about 3/4 of the way and single lane, 2-lane highway the rest of the way. And that's all getting fixed. But by the way, 3 hours is the ultimate amount of time any Irish person would stay in a car. More than 3 hours, we got to sleep overnight. We cannot do, they cannot cope with American distances. Let's look at the population. It is 1.5% of the US population. It has the same population of Alabama, the 24th most populous US state. Here's the statistic I love, the second to the last. When 400,000 Irish bought tickets to see Garth Brooks perform at Croke Park Stadium in Dublin, that was 10% of the entire population of the Republic. Extraordinary. So, all this to say how extraordinarily unlikely it is to suggest that such a minuscule country could lead the world in anything, let alone poetry. If Ireland is a prize fighter, it's definitely punching above its weight. For various reasons, Ireland and the Irish have exerted an oversized fascination around the world. Many have tried to explain the Irish. Here are some great quotes. I love the first one. The great Gaels of Ireland are the men that God made mad, for all their wars are merry and all their songs are sad. The third quote is too good to be true, and it isn't. This is a fantastic quote. It appears in the what's the movie, the gangster movie set in Boston, directed by Scorsese. Oh, you guys can't talk. You know what I'm talking about. It appears in that. The only people who cannot be psychoanalyzed. They're too ready to invent dreams or to contrive lies more interesting than truth. For he never said that, but he should have. One of the great jokes is God created whiskey to keep the Irish from ruling the world. And then we have two interesting quotes from Joyce and Wilde as well. Well, a final essential coordinate can be added to geography and population, and that is Irish history, which should effectively cancel all likelihood of Ireland's superiority and dominance. Despite its relative remoteness and relative insignificance, Ireland has been an attractive prize for invaders throughout its history. Its first inhabitants likely crossed a land bridge from mainland Europe at the end of the Ice Age, with the earliest evidence of human settlement around 6000 BC. The Iron Age Celts, beginning around 500 BC, brought their culture and Gaelic language to Ireland, eventually dominating and absorbing the Bronze Age native population. The Romans, by the way, never bothered with Ireland. They called it Hibernia, which meant land of perpetual winter, and the Mediterranean and the Romans just could not deal with Ireland's climate. Christian missionaries led by Palladius and Patrick began arriving in the 5th century, winning over those Celtic tribes and making possible the Irish monastic system that would keep Irish civilization alive throughout Europe following the collapse of the Roman Empire. The Vikings arrived beginning in 795, first as raiders, and later as colonists and founders of Ireland's first cities in Dublin, Wexford, Waterford, Limerick, and eventually blending with the native population. Each of these waves of invasions would add distinctive elements to the Irish character and identity, as well as redirecting Irish destiny. No invasion, however, would be as profound or as long-lasting as the arrival of the Normans from Britain in 1170. Invited to intervene in a dispute between Rory O'Connor, High King, and Dermot McMorra, regional king of Leinster, the English would become the dreaded house guests who overstayed their welcome by 800 years. You're looking here at the amazing Daniel MacLeese's mammoth billboard size Victorian era depiction of the Norman king or knight Strongbow to Aoife, his prize for coming to the aid of his father, her father, Dermot McMorra. It is both a triumphalist celebration of the English conquest. This painting is now in the National Gallery in Ireland, was meant to hang in the British House of Lords, and it was given to the Irish. It is also a moving elegy to the death of Celtic or Gaelic Ireland. You can see that in the foreground of this painting. Henry II of England had no intention of ceding a fiefdom as important as Ireland to Strongbow. So in 1171, to assert his sovereignty, he initiated the centuries-long effort to subdue and assimilate the unruly and largely uncooperative Irish. We haven't the time to review in any detail the torturous and tortured history of the 800 years of English rule in Ireland, nor the specific charges against the leading figures in the Irish nationalist pantheon of villainy, who include Oliver Cromwell, Charles Trevelyan, Queen Victoria, Lord George, Winston Churchill, and Margaret Thatcher. Only to say that the unifying strategies of the English occupation was displacement, translation, and subordination. The native Irish were gradually supplanted and subdued, becoming tenants on their own land, on land they had once owned, or dispersed to the barren reaches of the west of Ireland. If this reminds you of the treatment of Native Americans, it should. The entire native Irish population was forced to endure legal and legislative assaults on their customs, beliefs, language, and basic rights. Ireland's powerful next door neighbor basically defined the Irish as defective Englishmen who needed correction and deprogramming as the unruly id to the British superego, a benighted, superstitious race of papists and lazy, shiftless peasants who remained stubbornly resistant of the blessings of British materialism, work ethic, and empiricism. The English translation of the Irish into cultural stereotypes can be seen in this selection of cartoons. They're hard to look at. These appeared in Punch for the most part, mainline British publications. They are hard to look at. The middle image, it's too small for you to see, but I'll read you the caption. As we've dared to call the monkeys in the zoo by Irish names, Aaron's sons in wrath declare us snobs and flunkies and demand that we withdraw them. Nor should we ignore their claims, for it is really very hard upon the monkeys. I'll let that sink in for just a minute here. Well, these cartoons of the simian character of the Irish appeared more or less around the time of the great central trauma of Ireland, and that is the Great Famine. From 1845 to 1852, a potato blight throughout Europe destroyed the main food source for most of the Irish population. In 7 years, Ireland would lose between 20 and 25% of its population to starvation, disease, and emigration. In 1847 alone, Black 47, 1 million died, and more than a million escaped the country to an uncertain future. If you notice that population slide earlier on, it's the high water mark of Irish population was right before the famine. Over 8 million was the most populated, densely populated country in Europe. It lost, let's get my slide here. It almost immediately dropped to 6.6 million. And remember, its population now is 4.9 million. It's never even come close. The great Irish diaspora had begun. And Ireland would continue for the next century and more to hemorrhage its population to emigration in the aftermath of the famine. The British government that had pledged that the Irish were cherished members of the United Kingdom of Britain and Ireland, that was exposed as a lie. Grain and cattle were continuously exported out of Ireland all during the famine. And relief efforts were makeshift at best, inadequate, devolving largely to Irish landlords, grudging responsibility, most of whom responded by clearing their tenants from their land to avoid supporting them in taxes and shipping them off to North America as human ballast in the so-called coffin ships. Well, this is the kind of history so resistant to rhyming with hope that Heaney identifies. History as intractable, nightmarish, life-denying, that erased one in four of the Irish, turning its incomparable scenic beauty into a graveyard, or at best, a final glimpse for the millions who would never see their home again. This is history with a vengeance. How history functions in Ireland can best be understood in Heaney's great poem, Bogland.
Bogland, for T.P. Flanagan. We have no prairies to slice a big sun at evening. Everywhere the eye concedes to encroaching horizon is wooed into the cyclops eye of a tarn. Our unfenced country is bog that keeps crusting between the sights of the sun. They've taken the skeleton of the great Irish elk out of the peat, set it up an astounding crate full of air. Butter sunk under more than 100 years was recovered salty and white. The ground itself is kind black butter, melting and opening underfoot, missing its last definition by millions of years. They'll never dig coal here, only the waterlogged trunks of great firs, soft as pulp. Our pioneers keep striking inwards and downwards. Every layer they strip seems camped on before. The bog holes might be Atlantic seepage. The wet centre is bottomless.
Heaney writes, Our pioneers, as opposed to the American pioneers who have the prairie, who have that expansive horizon of continual movement, we've replaced in Ireland the horizontal with the vertical. Our pioneers keep striking inwards and downwards. Every layer they strip seemed camped on before. This is a brilliant summation of the haunted Irish landscape with its layer upon layer of historical impact and the challenge awaiting anyone hoping to redirect the Irish present and future from the bogland of the past. Two opposite responses emerged from the cataclysm of the Great Famine. One was parliamentary maneuvering by Irish members of parliament at Westminster to regain Irish home rule and a modicum of Irish self-respect and self-determination. The second was to achieve a break from English rule through any means necessary, including violence and what the English would condemn as acts of terror. The remarkable third option, or rather the prerequisite of any hope of Irish autonomy or independence, came from the most unlikely source, from poet and dramatist W.B. Yeats. Yeats recognized that the Irish first needed to deserve their self-determination by restoring Irish identity and consciousness, not as defined by the English, but by recalling and celebrating Ireland's heroic past and the characteristics that made Ireland unique and the Irish unique, not as defective Englishmen, but as superior to the materialistic English in their capacity for wonder and transcendent vision. In effect, what Yeats set out to do is what James Joyce has his young hero, Stephen Dedalus, grandiloquently proclaim in Portrait of the Artist, that his mission is to forge in the smithy of my soul the uncreated conscience of my race. Yeats's plan is going to be somewhat more successful than Dedalus's was. It's been said that a slave will not or cannot resist his master unless he believes he's entitled to do so. Yeats took on the poetic mission of equipping the Irish with the heroic lineage necessary for self-assertion, redefining what being Irish entitled one to become, offering a radically alternative conception of Ireland and the Irish, nobler and grander than the limitations and stereotypes imposed by the English. Yeats therefore shows how poetry can serve politics in imagining an alternative historical narrative of heroic possibility and destiny to reclaim an Irish consciousness and break the cycle of subordination and inferiority that history dictated. At his most fundamental, poetry is life-affirming and life-delimiting. This is what Heaney has called the redress of poetry, the counterbalance of an alternative, sustaining and transcendent reality to set beside the stubbornly denying forces of history. In this way, the Irish becomes victors over, not victims of history, masters of their own destiny and worthy of independence and nationhood. Without too much exaggeration, Ireland as an independent nation and as a force on the world stage owes as much to its poets and writers as it does to its resistance fighters and to its politicians, and to Yeats most of all. So, where on earth did Yeats come to this conclusion? Where did he come to his understanding of a different heroic Ireland? Well, look no further than Sligo on Ireland's northwest coast. This is where the young Yeats escaped from genteel poverty in London and the Irish, being an Irish anomaly in his English school as the eldest grandson of the most important businessman in Sligo, where he was set free to roam across Sligo's remarkable landscape. Sligo is where significantly the late developing Yeats learned to read and where he also learned to translate the Irish landscape into visionary clarity. His aunt once told him, here, that is Sligo, you are somebody. There, that is London, you are nobody. So in effect, Sligo formed Yeats' identity, and he would use his identity to transform Irish identity. Sligo is ruled by two great dramatic prominences. To the north, Ben Baldwin, the snub-nosed table mountain. That, by the way, is as tall as the Sears Tower in Chicago. It is an unavoidable source of mystery and myth. It is on Ben Baldwin that the Irish Romeo and Juliet, Dermot and Grania, met their tragic end. And it's on Ben Baldwin that Yeats was convinced, in the perfect light, you could see the small white door from which the she, the fairy folk, remnants of the ancient first inhabitants of Ireland would emerge. And by the way, when I say fairy folk, please do not conjure Tinkerbell. The she are, at least in the Irish imagination, fierce, formidable, potential, hostile, potent forces that you cross at your own peril. To the south is another great peak, Knocknarea. Atop Knocknarea is a massive Neolithic stone cairn, 200 feet in diameter. You can see it there, peeking out. More, you can see it here better. It is 200 feet in diameter and formed with an estimated 27,000 tons of stone. The people who made this wanted to call attention to themselves. This is a publicity move. The cairn has never been excavated, and in the absence of fact, legend thrives. It's popularly called Maeve's Cairn, after the infamous Iron Age warrior, Queen of Connacht, celebrated in the great Irish epic, the Tanbo Cooley, or the cattle raid of Cooley. Maeve's envy over her husband's prized bull causes her to lead an invasion of Ulster to claim the legendary brown bull of Cooley. Maeve's forces are stopped decisively by the great Ulster Achilles, Cú Chulainn. And we will return to Cú Chulainn in just a minute. I'm getting dizzy with this slide, so I gotta get another one here. Okay, there we go. It can be argued, this is another nice view of Maeve's tomb. It can be argued that Maeve is the first great woman warrior in world literature. Helen of Troy is a wilting violet compared to the ferocious Queen of Connacht. She is said to be buried, seated on her throne, perpetually facing north, on guard against Ulster retaliation. Well, if Maeve is there, she is occupying a Neolithic site built more than 3,000 years before the first century Maeve. Yeats, of course, would have heard all of these stories, as well as seen the largest collection of Neolithic dolmens and cairns in the world. For the locals, these were places of mystery and danger from which the young, fascinated Yeats would have been told to keep away. He would have heard as well, mainly from the Catholic servants of his grandfather and uncles, about the fairies and the she who entered and transformed his imagination. Well, why go any further with slides when we have a visitor from that other world in the west of Ireland with us this evening? Damien, are you there, my friend?
I'm here, Dan. Can you hear me?
So we're glad you, oh, there he is. There he is. Welcome. How are things in Ireland? Are you doing okay?
We're coping fine. We're all locked down, which isn't much fun. And of course, it's well after midnight here, and it's a filthy wet night outside with the wind blowing and the rain howling. So it's very Irish just now.
I'm showing a couple pictures of you in better days when we were all entertained at your house. And we hope to get there. We hope to get back to the new house sometime soon. Damien is condemned to look on this scenery every day he gets up. I mean, come on, it doesn't get any worse than that. Come on. Well, we're delighted to have you here. We miss you. Are people in Ireland missing us? That's what I want to know, whether everyone's saying, thank God the Americans have stopped coming for a while.
No. We need you all back, and very sooner the better.
All right, that'll be great. So you heard some of the things that I said about Sligo. Anything you want to add? I want you to read a couple poems, if you would. Would that be okay?
No problem at all. And let's start with the Lake Isle of Innisfree. There you are. But go back one for me for a moment.
Yeah.
And
Is that the one you want?
Yeah, because the scenery photograph here, where the rainbow is going down over the mountain, is exactly where the Lake Isle of Innisfree is. And it's one of Yeats's best known poems. It's by no means his most important one, but it is very much his best known poem. And he wrote it as a young man. He had been in Sligo for the summer, went back to London, was very homesick, was walking down, sometimes he says Fleet Street, sometimes he says the Strand, and he heard water tinkling in a little fountain in a shop window. And he was instantly struck with this huge sense of loss for Sligo, for the land of heart's desire. He had been reading Thoreau on Walden Pond, and he thought that he should take Thoreau's model and come out to this lake, which is far bigger than the pond in New England. It's 7 miles long and 3 miles wide, and that he should come out and live alone in the Beelow Glade, as he said himself. And out of this very youthful poem, and he wrote, or out of this youthful enthusiasm, he wrote this early poem, The Lake Isle of Innisfree. Innis is the Gaelic word foreign island. We still have a lot of Gaelic in our language. And free, Freyac, is the Gaelic word for heather. So it's Heather Island. The Lake Isle of Innisfree. I will arise and go now and go to Innisfree, and a small cabin built there of clay and wattles made. 9 bean rows will I have there, a hive for the honey bee, and live alone in the bee-loud glade. And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the vales of the morning to where the cricket sings, their midnights all a glimmer, and noon a purple glow, and evening full of the linnet's wings. I will arise and go now, for always night and day, I hear lake water lapping with low sounds by the shore. While I stand on the roadway or on the pavements gray, I hear it in the deep heart's core.
All right. I always like to end this poem by showing Annie West, a Sligo artist, her interpretation. It's a very romantic view, and Annie gives us what might really have happened had he left, that the Beelowd Glade would have stung him and he would never get his 9 bean rows in a row. So I think that's a good good anecdote.
Interesting thing in your theme of this evening is that, of course, President Clinton, during the peace process, made great use of that line, peace comes dropping slow. So it's not all just Biden and Kennedy that have Yeats in their words.
Okay. All right, let's have the Song of Wandering Angus.
Okay. Right? Okay. Well,
One of the
things I was going to add to what you were saying earlier on, Dan, is that Yeats dreamt himself into being a poet. He told Literary London and Literary Dublin when he was only 16 or 17 or 18, I am Yeats the poet. And he put on a pince-nez, and he put on a cravat, and he put on a cloak, and he dreamt himself into being a poet. At the age of 24 in 1889, they were having an afternoon tea party. They were pretty, very much middle class and well-to-do at one level, but there was always a shortage of money because his artist father failed to ever complete a painting. He was quite a good artist, but he was never happy with his work, and so he didn't get paid. But he was a marvelous conversationalist and a tremendous wit, and they gave afternoon tea parties that the great and the good of London. They lived in Blenheim Road in Chiswick, and the great and the good of London came to afternoon tea. Yeats was standing one afternoon, looking out the window, waiting for people to arrive, when a carriage, a horse and carriage pulled up outside, and the most beautiful woman he had ever seen stepped down and said to the cabbie, to Yeats's amazement, "Wait for me, I'll only be a half an hour. Leave the meter running." And she called with a letter of introduction from the Irish-American Fenian leader, John O'Leary, who was a great friend of John Butler Yeats's, the poet's father. And she came to call on him while she was visiting in London. And Yeats was absolutely bowled over. He fell head over heels in love for her there and then. He said two things of that day. He said she had all the delicacy and the beauty of apple blossom. And then he remarked, "That was the day the ruining of my life began," because she kept him in her thrall for 30 years at least. The Song of Wandering Angus is one of the early poems that he writes about this love affair. Angus is the Celtic god, god of love. And the notion of wandering could be that he was mendicant, he was traveling through the landscape, or more particularly, maybe he was beginning to lose his wit a little. People, when I was a child, if you said to my grandmother, "How is so-and-so?" she might say, "Ah, they're wandering. They're not quite there anymore." But Yeats writes this poem, The Song of Wandering Angus. "I went out to the hazel wood because a fire was in my head, and cut and peeled a hazel wand and hooked a berry to a thread. And when white moths were on the wing and moth-like stars were flickering out, I dropped the berry in a stream and caught a little silver trout. When I had laid it on the floor, I went to blow the fire aflame, but something rustled on the floor and someone called me by my name. It had become a glimmering girl with apple blossom in her hair, who called me by my name and ran and faded through the brightening air. Though I am old with wandering through hollow lands and hilly lands, I will find out where she has gone, and kiss her lips and take her hands, and walk among long dappled grass, and pluck till time and times are done, the silver apples of the moon, the golden apples of the sun."
That's great.
I'll ask your female, and yesterday was Women's International Day, so don't put me down as misogynistic, but what would you give to have a poem like that written for you?
This is a wee bit outside of my narrative, and I am mindful of the time. I don't want to keep everybody much beyond my hour, but I can't have Damien with us without inviting him to tell a story that he's told to my students here at Cape Cod Community several times. Whenever I used to teach English 102 when it was a literature course, I'd always start with Seamus Heaney's poem, Midterm Break. And I have it here. And it is a heartbreaking poem based upon Heaney's own life. At 14 years old, he gets the call that his four-year-old brother, Christopher, has been hit and killed by an automobile. And he has to come back to home to confront that reality. So it's this young boy trying to make sense of the incongruities and ambiguities of death. He sees, the first thing he sees is his father crying on the front porch. He holds his mother's hand and she can't cry. And the other alternative is the baby in the pram who sees her brother, who he sees for the first time in several weeks, and he's delighted. He's laughing, cooing, shaking the pram, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so now, Damien, I've set you up.
You've set me up very well, Dan. Thank you.
Let's go. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So the clue to my story goes back to the baby cooed and laughed and rocked the pram. And when Heaney died, how many years ago now? 10 years ago?
Five years ago,
okay. When Heaney died, there was a quandary for the family as to where they might bury him. Would they bury him in Dublin? Would they bury him in Wicklow, where he spent a good deal of his life, the county adjacent to Dublin? Or should they take him back home? And Mary Heaney and his three children, very generously in a way, agreed or suggested, you know, we should take him back home to Ballaghy. Ballaghy is the village that he grew up in the heart of Northern Ireland, on the shores of Loch Ness. And so they brought him back there and buried him in the local churchyard, Catholic churchyard, which is very, very big church, very big churchyard. And they found a small incline at the top of the back of the church and at the top of the hill, and they were able to lay him to rest there. And I have a friend who has a very, very sporty son, and he, as a 12-year-old, and again, he's 19 probably now, or 17, he was very taken by this poem, Midterm Break. And his mum said to him, she said, why don't you learn it off? Why don't you have it? And you'll always have it, and you'll be able to give it as your party piece in the future as you grow up and whatever else. So he learned the poem off. Some months later, they were traveling back to his father's place in Northern Ireland from Sligo, and they saw the sign for Ballaghy. And she thought, well, the very thing, we'll take him over to Ballaghy and show him where Seamus Heaney is buried. So they went up the back of the church, up the back of the churchyard, past a couple who were tending a grave, and went up and paid their respects to the grave. Whether they said a prayer or whether he said the poem or whatever, I don't know. But they saw the grave. And as they were coming back down, the couple that were tending another grave that they passed on the way up said to them, where did you come from? Now this, as Dan will tell you, is typically Irish, north or south. Where are you? Who are you? Where are you from? And so on. You'll be asked questions you'd never be asked in America. And so the man said, where did you come from? And Kathleen said, well, we came from Sligo, but we're going over to further over to his dairy, to down to my in-laws. And she said, my son likes that poem, you probably know it. And that's why we called. And so the man said to him, will you give me the poem? That's a nice way of saying, will you recite it for me? An Irish way of saying it. Will you give me the poem? And the young lad gave the poem in its entirety. And then the elder man said, I'm that baby. This was the baby who cooed and laughed and rocked the pram, Seamus Heaney's brother. And that's how immediate poetry is in Ireland. That's how close you can get to it. You can meet somebody who's been in the poem. And equally, you can meet in Sligo, if you come to visit us, you can easily meet the places that Yeats made so alive. They're all still here, and they're all still here to be found.
Here's Heaney's grave right there. And this is the grave, the family grave, and Christopher is the first person on the grave. So that's an only in Ireland story. So I'm delighted, even though it took us off our timetable here. So we're gonna have to say goodnight to Sligo. I hate to say that, and I hope that we're there in person.
And not Niall is here with me as well on the other couch.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Damien. And I'm conscious of my time here. So I
will go ahead.
Yeats emerges from his Sligo experience. He puts this notion of Irish identity in motion through poem, through story, through plays. He comes up with a way to get the Irish able to see themselves enacted outside of the role of the stage Irishman by creating, with Lady Gregory and others, the Irish National Theater that becomes the Abbey Theater. A couple of interesting things here. If you look at the logo of the Abbey Theater, from its beginning in 1904, that's Queen Maeve and her Irish wolfhound. So this is a kind of an echoing of Knocknarea, and this logo is still in use at the Abbey Theater. So Yeats's Sligo time comes into play as well. Right now, if you go to when the Abbey reopens, you will see this particular portrait of Yeats in the lobby. When I see it, I always think of Queen Maeve dutifully staring north on guard against the oncoming Ulster army. And I think of Yeats, he's sort of looking at the box office, keeping his eyes fixed on that day's takings. So that is my image of Yeats. He will be absolutely stunned and shocked that on Easter Monday, 1916, a ragtag band of amateur weekend soldiers, students, school teachers, and more than one poet decided to act on Yeats's heroic identity, marching down Abbey Street, past the Abbey Theater, to occupy sites in central Dublin. Patrick Pearse would read the proclamation. Here's the proclamation. It could be, in effect, a kind of mission accomplished. Let me just read the opening of the proclamation to you. It opens with a kind of clarion call that could be read as Yeats's mission accomplished. Irish men and Irish women, in the name of God and of the dead generations from which she receives her old traditions of nationhood, Ireland through us summons her children to her flag and strikes for her freedom. That's Yeats' language. Yeats, of course, would later wonder, was he responsible? Because what the English did next is appalling. They pulled the full weight of the English military, 16,000 strong, to put down 1,200 rebels. They brought a gunboat up the Liffey and they shelled the center of Dublin. The first time, and I believe the only time in English history, that the full might of the British Army was trained on what was, in a sense, the second great city in the British Empire, Dublin. It was reduced to rubble. You can see the GPO, the General Post Office, it's a shell. Yeats was taken with this notion. And he asked himself over and over, was I responsible? The great poem, the definitive poem about the rising, arguably the greatest poem written in the 20th century, is Easter 1916, which is a litany of questions, not answers, questions, containing the ambiguity perfectly in the oxymoronic refrain, a terrible beauty is born. If you go to Dublin today, you can still see remnants. This is from the O'Connell statue. You can see Lady Victory, one of the Victories, with a bullet hole in her chest. You can see the bullet scarring on the columns of the GPO. And if you go inside, you can see a statue in honor of the rebels. Now this is Cú Chulainn. We have to go back to Sligo for that reference. This is Cú Chulainn at the moment of his death. He has single-handedly stopped the army of Connacht fighting so ferociously that even in his death, his foes were too frightened to go near him until a raven came down and perched on his shoulder and told everyone the great warrior is dead. That is the statue at the center of the GPO. Now, it's rhyming with the crucifixion of Christ is intentional. So Yeats would ask the question, did my play, Kathleen Ni Houlihan, send those people off? He would continue to ponder the violence of the Irish War of Independence and the even bloodier Irish Civil War and the global violence that he saw coming in one of the greatest poems and probably the most quoted poem since 9/11 in the English-speaking world. All the way through the pandemic, you see references to Second Coming, turning and turning in the widening gyre, the falcon cannot hear the falconer, things fall apart, the center cannot hold, mere anarchy is loosed upon the world, the blood-dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. And here to me is the greatest political summation sentence I've ever read. The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity. Remind you of anything? Of course it does. This is poetry that Emily Dickinson would approve of. She writes, if I read a book and it makes my whole body so cold, no fire can warm me, I know that is poetry. If I feel physically as if the top of my head were taken off, I know that is poetry. These are the only ways I know it. Is there any other way? Brilliant. All right, I have to do some radical editing now because I know I'm at the end of my time. Damien, I've never seen this picture before. I found this when I was searching Google. I've never seen this particular color photo of Yeats. Yeats becomes a senator in the new Free State Parliament. He fights for recognition and trying to resist the inevitable sectarian divide that began to pull Ireland apart. One of the great sins of partition was the determination that the North is going to be Protestant, well, therefore the Republic has to be Catholic. And Yeats reminded all the senators of the great Irish Protestants who were as much involved in rebellion as anyone else. He comes to a great conclusion. He offers his sort of poetic conclusion in his great poem, Under Ben Bulbin. You see his grave here, overlooking Ben Bulbin. The poem is amazing. It provides an epitaph, burial instructions, and an exordium to future poets. So we'll just play the end of that.
Irish poets, learn your trade, sing whatever is well made. Scorn the sort now growing up, all out of shape from toe to top. Their unremembering hearts and heads, base-born products of base beds, sing the peasantry and then hard-riding country gentlemen. The holiness of monks and after, porter drinkers, randy laughter, sing the lords and ladies gay that were beaten into clay through 7 heroic centuries. Cast your mind in other days that we in coming days may be still the indomitable Irish re. Under Bear Ben Bulbin's head in Drumcliff churchyard Yeats is laid. An ancestor was rector there long years ago. A church stands near. By the road an ancient cross. No marble, no conventional phrase. On limestone quarried near the spot, by his command these words are cut. Cast a cold eye on life and death. Horsemen pass by.
Let me try to end very quickly. The transition figure I would want you to think about between Yeats and Heaney is this man, Patrick Cavanaugh, not as well known outside of Ireland, but very much loved. He was a Catholic, an Ulsterman from County Monaghan, a farmer, all identities that Heaney would respond to, because when Yeats says "sing the peasantry," there is no way that Yeats knew the peasantry in any kind of intimacy. He is of the noble side of the fence. Patrick Kavanagh is the real thing. Okay, the poem I wanted to have you take a look at is a poem called Epic. Well, really it's about how can you make epic poetry out of the local, out of the parochial. Kavanagh says one great line. He says, all great civilization originates from the parish. It's a brilliant line, okay? I'm gonna talk just a couple more minutes. I have to mention Evan Bolin. Bolin is, sadly, we lost her in 2010, 2020, I should fix that. Fix that right now. She, of course, is going to open up a different kind of voice to Irish poetry, largely a woman's voice. I have to let you hear her read Quarantine. I mean, it's heartbreaking. And she'll tell you a little about it. I'm almost done.
This poem follows a book that was published really at the beginning of the 20th century, a memoir of the famine. And it follows very briefly a couple of young people who left the workhouse in 1847, walked back to their cabin, and were found dead in the morning, a very bitter winter. But when they were found, he had held his wife's feet against his breast to try to warm them as she died. And that's what made the comment. And that becomes the end of the story for them. This is called Quarantine. In the worst hour of the worst season of the worst year of a whole people, a man set out from the workhouse with his wife. He was walking. They were both walking north. She was sick with famine fever and could not keep up. He lifted her and put her on his back. He walked like that, west and west and north, until at nightfall, under freezing stars, they arrived. In the morning, they were both found dead, of cold, of hunger, of the toxins of a whole history. But her feet were held against his breastbone, the last heat of his flesh, was his last gift to her. Let no love poem ever come to this threshold. There is no place here for the inexact praise of the easy graces and sensuality of the body. There is only time for this merciless inventory. Their death together in the winter of 1847. Also, what they suffered, how they lived, and what there is between a man and woman, and in which darkness it can best be proved.
It's a heartbreaking poem, but it's also heart-growing. This notion of such desperate history, but such incredible hope is exactly what I tried to communicate in my talk. I fear that I have done a poor job, but I'm going to end as all great essays should end, by returning to your thesis. I want to go back to this particular image. And if you look closely, and you probably noticed this is a volume of Yeats's poetry. Here's the portrait from the National Gallery that's on the back of the book. Now, this is Braden, the 14-year-old or 13-year-old who's getting instruction. This is on the campaign trail by Biden. And he's showing the young boy who's afflicted with stuttering how he himself, Joe Biden, attempted to cure him. And he uses the volume of Yeats' poetry. Now, I'm pretty convinced, even though this looks a little stagey, this picture, that's not Braden's volume of Yeats poetry. I can't imagine he brought that with him. And if this is a school, it looks like a school, I doubt if they had a copy of Yeats's poetry. This is Biden's copy of Yeats's poetry that he's bringing on the campaign trail. And so it is enormously consoling to me that of all of the responsibilities, all of the things that the President of the United States has to carry, including the launch codes, is today a volume of Yeats's poetry. And that in the White House Situation Room, there's room at the table for Irish poets. And why? Because as Heaney suggests, poets take us to an alternative that helps us to understand our limits and our possibilities. Shelley famously said, the poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world. And what did he mean by that? He meant, I think, that the poets are lawgivers, that they show us how the world is organized and they show us the way to evade that organization. I love the fact that Heaney's tombstone, in imitation of Yeats, you got the same granite and the same enigmatic epitaph, is walk on air against your better judgment. Everything about our lives pulls us back to earth. Gravity, common sense, timidity. And what is Heaney as a poet saying? He's offering us a different dimension, a different alternative. That's what I think the Irish poets in the room with Biden are offering him. And with that, I am out. Over. Done. Thank you.
Daniel, thank you so much for that absolutely riveting talk. Clearly, we should have had a half day workshop so that you could have talked more. I think this crowd could have listened all day. And I want to thank you for bringing your special guest, Damien. And now I know I want to thank you for giving the poem to us. And your lovely reading of the Yeats poems and your stories of Yeats and Seamus Heaney. I mean, this has been a magical night. And I just want to thank you so much. I feel so fortunate to work at Cape Cod Community College to have colleagues like Dr. Burt among our faculty. And I know there's people that are probably dying to ask you questions, but would it be okay if I put your email in the chat?
So here's what I'd like you to do. If you want this further readings, the list of poems, blah, 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 email me, dbert@capecod.edu. Is that good enough?
Yes, and I put that in the chat, and so people can copy and paste it. And I want to thank you all for coming, and I'd like to thank Vanna Trudeau and her team for running the show tonight. And of course, thank you to Daniel and the enormously talented faculty that we have at Cape Cod, and also to the Professional Development Committee who funded this. So thank you so much, everyone. Have a good night.
All right, bye-bye. Bye, everybody.